Previously, we saw what dithering is, why it's needed, and when to use it. In this video, we'll take a closer look at the different types of dither signals. They're generally categorized based on the technique, either non-subtractive or subtractive dither. The range, or the interval of the random values, usually measured in LSBs, or least significant bits. And based on the probability density function. All of this sounds complicated, but in fairness, there's not much to it. Consider this input signal. Let's say we apply a dither signal or noise to this input. Let's zoom in to a single time instance, a thin slice of this signal. Let's also imagine a range of values that can be added to or subtracted from this sample to create this dither signal. There could be an equal probability that the noise falls anywhere within this range. Or you could have a probability which is skewed such that there is more likelihood for the noise sample to fall in the middle of the interval, closer to the original sample. This expression of probability is called probability density function, or PDF for short. The simplest one to explain is the rectangular probability density function. This is essentially like rolling a die. All die faces are equally probable and there's no bias. So a dither signal with rectangular PDF produces a noise signal where the values are equally probable throughout the interval range. The next one is a triangular probability density function, or TPDF. As you can imagine from this graph, this density function is skewed and biased towards the middle of the interval. An example for this is rolling two dice and summing up the result. The probability of 1-1, or 6-6, being cast is quite low, but there are several possible combinations that results in a sum of 7. It's quite easy to achieve a triangular function programmatically for our dither signal. We just take two rectangular functions, one with a range of negative 1 to 0, and another with a range of 0 to 1. And we just add them together. Done. The last PDF we're going to discuss today is the Gaussian PDF, or normal PDF. An example for this would be the height of all the people in a given population, let's say. Some people may be very short. Some people may be extremely tall. But most people have an average height and fall somewhere in the middle of the distribution. The shape or the curve of the Gaussian PDF is determined by the RMS value, or sometimes called the standard deviation. Gaussian dither is quite easy to implement in the analog domain. A simple diode can be used as a noise source which produces Gaussian noise. And a lot of the time, an explicit dither signal is not really needed in the analog domain, since electronic components produce enough noise to self-dither. Gaussian PDF is generally not used for digital dither signals. Neither is rectangular PDF. The most commonly used function is the triangular PDF. There are reasons for this. The correlated distortion that quantization introduces can be mathematically measured. This graph is called an input-output characteristics graph, which is averaged out. It measures the linearity of an output signal after quantization against the original signal before quantization. A straight line matching the input and output levels indicate a linear quantization system where no distortion is present. If the line is skewed, it indicates that there is non-linearity in the quantization process, which essentially means correlated distortion is still present. We know that when dither is applied before quantization, the distortion generally disappears. But what is the strength of dither we need to linearize the system? A better way of putting this is asking, what is the minimum strength of dither we need to get away with not having any distortion in our output? The strength of a dither signal is measured in LSBs. The wider the interval of LSBs, the higher the strength of the dither signal, and higher is the noise floor of the output signal after quantization. If we apply rectangular dither when the measurements are averaged over a few thousand traces, these are the input-output characteristic curves you get for different LSBs. And we notice that in order to linearize the system with rectangular PDF dither, we need at least one LSB of strength. That's a range from negative 0.5 to 0.5. Beyond one LSB, the system loses linearity again and gains it at every integer multiple of the LSB. For a triangular PDF dither, we see that the dither needs a range of two LSBs to linearize the system. Beyond two LSBs, the system stays linearized. Looking at Gaussian PDF dither, since a Gaussian function has a theoretically infinite range on either side, we study the RMS value instead. The RMS value needed for Gaussian dither to linearize the system is half an LSB. On the face of it, the rectangular PDF looks like a better option. But for a strength of one LSB, there are instances for very low frequency signals where there's a risk of the noise being modulated by the input signal. So practically, we need two LSBs to avoid that. A two LSB triangular PDF is just more suitable than a two LSB rectangular PDF. Let's take a quick look at Reaper. There's a bit reduction slash dither plugin built in with loads of options. Since this is a JS plugin, you can actually take a look at the source code of this plugin. It's built using a scripting language that's compiled on the fly. So if you ever need to look at the math behind a plugin, you can check it out here and tweak it as well if you want to. We'll turn off all the noise shaping features for now, and we'll only look at rectangular and triangular dither types. The dither amplitude is set to 1 LSB. But that's an absolute value. The effective range of the values is from negative 1 to 1. So that's 2 LSBs effectively. I'll also bring up a VU meter here to monitor the levels. Once we reduce the bit depth to 8, we notice the dither noise. In the VU meter, the RMS value is generally a better indicator of loudness than the peak value, and we can see that the RMS value of the noise floor is around negative 45 dB full scale. If you use triangular dither, we see that the noise floor drops slightly to negative 48 dB FS. Another thing that I forgot to mention last time is that you don't need a fancy plugin for dither. It's mathematically well established and most DAW softwares have similar implementations. But if you explicitly use a plugin for dither, always be aware of possibility of accidentally dithering twice. For instance, if I wanted to render this track as a WAV file, Reaper has options for me to dither and noise shape the master. If I've applied dither at the track level, and if these options are checked during rendering, I would effectively be dithering the track twice, which is not what we want. Alright, so everything we've looked at so far falls under the category of non-subtractive dithering, which means we add the dither signal to our input signal before quantization, and that's it, we're done. Subtractive dithering, on the other hand, is an extension of the existing technique, where we take the same dither signal and subtract it from the output. This would lower the noise floor quite a bit. Though this seems like a great solution, practically implementing it is harder than it seems. That's because we need a way to transmit the dither signal to the output beyond the quantization boundary and not have the dither signal be quantized as well. One way of doing this is to use a pseudo random number generator with an agreed upon seed value, followed by a DAC as the source of analog dither noise. This makes it possible to transmit discrete values instead of analog noise, and hence dither subtraction becomes more realistic. It's way beyond the scope of this module, so we're not going to look at that. Coming up next is noise shaping and how it's applied in tandem with dithering to reduce our perception of the noise in the output signal.